give myself to you so you can use me. I give myself away. You know, that's what I have to do, because my mother said to God when we were in the ER, if you keep my babies, I'll give them back to you. And they'll give themselves back if you just save my babies. She told me that when I was a young girl. So it's my duty to give myself away, because my mother made a promise to the Lord like Hannah did. Hannah said, God, if you just give me a child, I'll give him back. So when my mother told me that, I thought it was my duty to just give myself away. My life is not my own. To you I belong. Give myself to you. Can we give God a hand praise?
Amen, amen. I give myself away to God so that he can use me. Amen, Pastor Hassan. I don't think you could hear me over here, but I was trying to give you some backup.
I heard you.
You heard me? Okay, amen. Praise God. Amen. I sure was, brother. Amen. 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 I know how hard it is to carry worship by yourself. Amen. Amen. Let us not forget there was a day when your pastor was your minister of music. Amen. 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 Pastor Leslie, we gave out programs and band-aids. Amen. Because ears were bleeding. Amen. But I'm so happy to know that God has blessed us with a worship leader that gives her all of herself every single time. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles, why don't you turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew? Amen. We're going to be in the 20th chapter, Matthew chapter 20, looking at verses 29 through 34. So that's Matthew chapter 20, verses 29 through 34. If you have it and you do not mind standing, would you stand for the reading of the word? The New Revised Standard Version of the scripture reads as follows. As Jesus, the disciples, and his regular followers were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed them. There were two blind men sitting by the roadside. When they heard that Jesus was passing by, these men shouted, Lord, have mercy on us, son of David. The crowd sternly ordered the blind men to be quiet, but they shouted even more loudly, have mercy on us, Lord, son of David. Jesus stood still and called these two men, saying, what do you want me to do for you? They said to him, Lord, let our eyes be opened. Moved with compassion, Jesus touched these men's eyes. Immediately, they regained their sight and followed Jesus. Thus far, the word of God. You may be seated in his presence. The title of today's sermon is, What Do We Want Jesus to Do for Us? What do we want Jesus to do for us? You know, if God were to suddenly appear in this sanctuary right now and tell us that he will do anything we want him to do, or he will give us anything we want, do we know what it is we would ask for? Here it is. The God of all creation, the God of everything, is saying that anything you want, I'll give it to you. The only catch is you can ask for one thing. One thing. Doesn't matter what it is, one thing. Now, I know we've got a laundry list of things we want. Amen. Praise God. I know. So guess what? Someone wants to be rich. You know what? Someone wants to be tall. Someone wants to be short. Amen. You ask tall people. Amen. They want to be short. They don't want to be tall anymore. Amen. So someone wants to be the boss. Someone no one wants to be the boss. Amen. Someone wants to be married. Someone wants to be divorced. Someone wants a new car. Someone wants an antique. What? There's a laundry list of what we want. But if God asked you, what do you want me to do? And he limited you to one thing, what would your answer be? You see, that's the contents of our scripture this morning. Jesus and the disciples and his regular followers, I intentionally wanted you to see that. They're leaving Jericho, amen. Jesus is spending time during the daytime in Jerusalem, but he's bedding at the bed and breakfast at the Airbnb in Jericho. It's a morning, amen. Let's assume it's Monday morning, Tuesday morning, Wednesday morning. It's a morning. He's got up. He's got himself together. He got his disciples together. His regular followers, Mary of Magdalene, the mother, Joanna, all of them that regularly follow him are ready, and they're making their way out of Jericho. And we're told that two blind men could sense that Jesus was there. He was passing them by. We don't know how they could sense it, but they could sense that they were in the presence of God. And when they realized they were in the presence of God, they started hollering out to Jesus, wanting Jesus to have mercy. Now, here's the interesting thing. Amen. Last week, we were in Jericho. Amen. We were at Jericho, and we were there at Jericho, and we were looking at how God literally empowers us, equips us through prayer to tear down walls, barriers, things that are keeping us from operating in the fullness of God's grace and mercy, in the fullness of his will, the fullness of his power. That was last week's sermon, but this week we're back in Jericho, but it's been thousands of years. A lot of time has passed, and in that time, someone has rebuilt Jericho. In fact, a whole lot of someones have rebuilt Jericho. Amen. The Israelites, when they first got there, tore it down, but it's been rebuilt. And here is Jesus leaving Jericho to go to Jerusalem on the one road. There was one road that connected Jericho and Jerusalem. It's like I-85 connects Gastonia to Charlotte, or Concord to Charlotte, like I-77 connects Huntersville to Charlotte, or Rock Hill to Charlotte. There's one straight road that they could take, and they're on the road, and they're walking, and these two blind men recognize, amen. They sense that Jesus is there with them, amen. And they start hollering out, amen, praise God. And it just, it amazes me that these two blind men who could not see could know that Jesus is in their presence. Two blind men who don't have the ability to perceive visually can see exactly who Jesus is, even though persons all around him cannot. Give me my first point. Amen. Give me my first point. Amen. Can we recognize when the Lord God Almighty is in our presence? Can we presence of God, feeling what it felt like when God inhabited the same space, the same time? They knew God. Now, I know it doesn't say it right there in the scripture. You never see anything about them praying. Amen. In fact, if we're going to say they prayed, I guess the best you could say is their plea to Jesus, Lord, have mercy on me, son of David, and then their request to see but here's the thing, that there's some prayers that we don't always mention with our mouths. Amen. There's some prayers we pray in our spirit. In fact, there's sometimes I'm praying and I'm around you and you don't know I'm praying. praying because I've gone into my spiritual closet and I've lifted up some prayers. In fact, why would I share with you what I'm praying about when many folks do not care what I'm praying about? In fact, if they knew what I was praying about, they'd probably pray against me that it wouldn't happen. So there are many times when I pray to myself. I don't make it known. But here's the thing. The time I spend in God's presence praying has prepared me to recognize his presence. Let me give you a real life example of what I'm talking about. 2 weeks ago, I was told that a certain condition was occurring. Amen. That a certain thing was happening with us. Amen. And so I was a little taken aback. Not taken aback thinking that God can't do it, but taken aback that this had become a concern. And so it beat me up. It made me mad. I've been laying in my bed saying, God, if you don't deal with this, boy, I'm gonna let some heads roll. You know, I'm gonna drop the hammer on some folks. If you don't deal with this right this very minute, God, show us that we're good. That was a prayer. So that Monday, so I prayed that prayer. So yeah, I prayed that prayer on a Sunday. That Monday, I needed to go get a tux. There's a formal function that's going to happen in a few days, and so I needed to go get a tux. And I had told myself in the past, and my wife, that the tux, it costs so much now to rent a tux. When I was growing up, we had Mitchells. Mitchells, you get them for $59.99. And to rent the tux was only $30 less than buying the tux. So I told my wife, the next time I have to go rent a tux, I'm just going to buy it. Because no need to pay it and then have to bring it back, then have to come back and pay another. I just might as well rent it. I can dry clean it myself. So I went to the store where I normally go get my suits. I had gone on the website. They said there were suits and tuxes at the place. I went to the store. I got there, and the man said, we have no tuxes. I said, but right here. I flipped my phone around. He said, I know sometimes the website is not right. They give you incorrect information. I said, oh. So feeling dejected, feeling down, I start to turn around. I start to walk out. He said, hold up. Wait a second. Let me look and see if we have this tux at another store. I said, okay, got nothing else to do. So he looks on the computer, there is another tux. It's at the Moorcroft store. So I said, call him, tell him to hold on, I'm coming to get it. So I go get in my car, I'm racing through the streets. About hit three old women. That's just a joke. That's just a joke. That's just a joke. That's just a joke. I don't want you. Amen. Well, two. Amen. The third one got away. Amen. She got out of the way, Brother Sean. So I got there. I walked in the store. I was told to ask for Doc. Doc's the manager. So I said, who's Doc? He said, I'll talk to you in a second. And so he said, he was walking away. He said, so what are you here for? I said, my name's Al Kennan. They called from the Blakeney, from the Ballantyne's Common store. Oh, yeah. He said, this is what I need you to do. Think about what kind of shirt you want to wear with your tux. I said, shirt? I'm coming to get a tux. He said, you can't buy a tux without buying a shirt. See, here's the thing. I've rented tuxes so much. All that comes together. You don't have to think about it. In fact, they take your measurements, and then you come back in a few days and you got your tux. And so he was asking me questions. Well, are you going to wear it just with a bow tie? Are you going to wear it with a tie? Are you going to wear it with the studs or just the buttons? Or the, you know, he took me through all that. And I was like, that's interesting. I never thought about this. Because typically, like I said, when I come in to get a tux, they've got the tux already together for me. I just had to come in, pay my $59, and I got my tux. Amen. And so we were talking. And at one point he said, when will you need the tux by? And I said, by Saturday the 25th. He said, oh, we can't get you this tux. I said, why not? He said, because our tailoring department is 2.5 weeks out on stuff. Okay. So I sat down. I said, all right, God, I get it. I get it. I ain't meant to go. God said, no, that ain't what I'm doing. He said, watch this. And so this other person, employee, walked by and said, such just came back from lunch. She's upstairs hemming stuff. Doc said, go up there and ask her if she can hem these pants right quick. He said, you got time? Say yes. So she went upstairs. He went upstairs and came back down. She said, yeah, bring them up. Mark them up. Bring them up. So we marked them up. She took them upstairs, hemmed them. Again, working this out. I didn't ask for any of this. All right. So I'm getting to the good part here. Okay. So we do this. We get everything together. Get all the pieces together. So I get to the cash register, and I you know, in my heart, I'm like, all right, God, here comes that cost. It's gonna beat me up. We're gonna have to have peanut butter and jelly for the next 20 years, paying off this tuxedo. So I get to the register, and Doc says, I'm going to hook you up. I said, uh-oh. You know, the hookup. And so he says, I'm going to go ahead and take $100 off the tux. I was like, oh, praise Jesus. Amen. So my shirt, he said, I'm going to take such and such off the shirt. He said, I'm going to cut the hemming for you in half. By the time he was finished cutting prices, the tux that I bought was cheaper with the discounts and everything he did than if I had just bought the tux by itself without anything else. I end up paying less. So here's the thing. I know you're saying, okay, God, okay, Pastor, why are you sharing this? I'm sharing that because remember what my prayer was. My prayer wasn't to get a tux. My prayer was that whatever the situation was, that God, you would handle it. You would give us a sign that it was going to happen. And so here's the thing. What I have learned is sometimes we ask God to give us signs, and then we're looking over here when we need to be paying attention over there. What happened that Monday getting that tux was all God. It could have ended when I walked through the store and they said they did not have any more tuxes available, but God orchestrated that thing, took me to another store, got me fitted, got me hemmed, got my shirt, got my peripherals, marked the price down, and I walked out that store saying, God, I got it. You've got us. You're going to help us. You're going to bless us. We don't have to worry about it. I mean, I got in my car, got on my cell phone, and I sent emails like, don't you worry about it. God says he's got it. And I told him, I said, if God says it, that settles it for me. I don't want to have any more discussion about this. He's got it. What am I saying? Why did I share that story with you? Because I want you to know I have been in God's presence so much that when certain things happen, I realize I'm in his presence. And when I realize I'm in his presence, I have to give him praise. I have to give him glory. I have to shout his name. I got to scream hallelujah at the top of my voice, at the top of my lungs, because I realize God has blessed me with his presence. Here's the thing. Every single day, God is blessing someone with his presence. God is showing up in someone's life. And every day we're treating him just like he's another bump on the log. Every time God opens a door for you, he's in your presence. Every time he closes a door for you, he's in your presence. Every time he makes a way out of no way, he's in your presence. Every time he tells you yes, he's in your presence. Every time he tells you no, he's in your presence. Every time he tells you not yet, he's in your presence. There is never not a time God doesn't bless you with his presence. And it's imperative upon us to be able to recognize when God is here. Don't you let someone that can't see God quicker than you. These blind men couldn't see. Didn't know an apple from an orange. Amen. Couldn't tell a Ferrari from a Lamborghini. They didn't know, couldn't see. But they knew they were in the presence of God. Amen. So give me my first point again. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. First point is, can you recognize when the Lord God Almighty is in our presence? Here's the next point. How often do we let what other people want stop us from receiving what we most desire from the Lord God Almighty? How often do we let what other people want stop us from receiving what we most desire from the Lord God Almighty? If you read Matthew chapter 20, verses 25 through 34, it says at some point while these men are calling out to Jesus, the crowd sternly orders them to be quiet. Now, here's the thing. I got to be honest with you. I have made a mistake for a long time. I assumed that the crowd was the disciples and the Jesus' regular followers. I assumed it was the disciples telling him and the people that follow Jesus regularly telling him to be quiet. But when you read it plainly, it is not the disciples and his regular followers. It's the people in Jericho who are leaving with Jesus, following him because they've heard what he can do. And what they are thinking, they're thinking that these two men are going to distract Jesus from doing something miraculous, doing something amazing, and they won't be able to see it. So they order him or them to be quiet. Says they got louder, but the people are ordering to be quiet. And I was meditating with God on this, and it made me sit here and think, how many times has someone in my life stopped me from getting what I most want from God because they were not happy that I was pursuing God? Now, as I'm saying it, I know each one of you are sitting there thinking, ooh, who's that enemy of Pastor Al's? Who's that adversary of Pastor Al? Who's that hater that has tried to come against Pastor Al? But let me tell you, I've seen family and friends come against. Amen. Praise God. Trying to sit down and work on a sermon. Telling family, hey, I'm working on a sermon. Okay, but let me ask you one quick question. I'm working on a sermon. But I just gonna take 10 minutes of your time. I'm working on a sermon. What? Hey, what you doing? Preparing for Bible study? Well, okay, I just called it as if I didn't say, if I say I'm doing nothing. Hey, dog. Frat brothers. Hey, dog. I know you got this going on. But can you come by? I got a ticket. Dude, I'm going to be in court 200 miles away from here. But you can just run by and do the ticket before you go. You're missing the point. I can't show up at 9 here and 9 there. I'm 200 miles away. Persons who you are familiar with. Because here's the thing. These people telling these blind men to be quiet, they weren't strangers. They were fellow citizens of Jericho. Probably neighbors. Probably family friends. Probably family. Come on, y'all. Come on. Come on. Tell me the truth. All right. Okay. Pastor Leslie, me and you, because we the only ones gonna tell the truth right now. Let's be for real. There's sometimes your family thinks you embarrass them. They think you embarrass them. And what they tell you, please don't embarrass me. You know, you shout too loud. You're too animated. Yeah. But to them, you are embarrassing them. And what they, in fact, you know, so you got to watch family, because you look up, you'll be over here, they'll be over there. Amen. I'm talking to someone. Amen. You ain't got to amen me. I know I'm talking to you. Because here's the thing. You've been wanting to come down here and be a part of what we got going on First Fellowship. I'm talking to you in Indian, not Indian land. Lord have mercy. In internet land. Amen. Indian land is a city right here in Charlotte. Amen. But I'm talking to you in internet land. You've been wanting to come down here to experience what we've got going on in person, but someone has said to you, you don't need to go down there. Why you need to go down there if they got it on internet? That's why they got it on internet. We've got it on the internet as a courtesy. But here's what Paul says, do not forsake fellowshipping with the saints. How are you fellowshipping with us and you're home and we're here? Come on, someone, come tell me the truth. You, here it is. You've been trying to go back to school for a while. You know that one person. Well, you know what? I ain't paying for it. If you're gonna do this, you're gonna do this on your own. I ain't staying up with you. I ain't reading nothing. I ain't reading over nothing. I ain't checking nothing. In other words, what they're trying to do is trying to put you in a place where you feel like you're doing this all by yourself, and the fear of doing it all by yourself would be enough to stop you from doing it. Come on, tell the truth, shame the devil. Here it is, you trying to get yourself together. You trying to be different. You trying to walk a new life. You trying to save your money, get out of debt. You trying to exercise, eat right, have a healthy lifestyle. And here comes your girlfriend or your homeboy. What you doing that for? We went down to such and such all-you-can-eat fried fish seafood buffet, and you weren't there because I can't eat that anymore. Oh, you tripping. You think you better than us. You think you too good for us. You popping your collar. You acting like you. That's them not wanting you to get what you most desire from the Lord. The question is, are you bold enough to respond like these brothers responded? Amen. Are you bold enough to say to someone, I don't care what you think. I don't care if you don't want to go praise God, and I definitely don't care that you don't want me to praise God, because as I have life, as I have being, I am going to praise the Lord. In fact, I'm going to shout louder, Jesus, Lord of mercy, have favor on me. I'm going to pray more, Father God, in the name of heaven. I'm back again to pray. I'm going to tithe more. I'm going to serve more. I'm going to work more. In fact, the more you try to hold me back, the more you try to shut me down, the more you try to act like a barrier between me and God, the more determined you're making me to get to God. In fact, let me talk to someone. When the last time someone stopped you from getting to God? And what does that say about you? Okay, amen. Come on, amen. So I know I got three single ladies right here. Amen. Four. Five. Well, you're married. Amen. You're married. You're in the married category. Four. Amen. Whoever's gonna get your heart? No, you're married too. You know, trying to see. Look at her. And wasn't gonna correct me either. She gonna sit up there and that. Yeah, girl, I'm single today. Yeah, and I want to see what he gonna say. You're married too. Amen. If anyone is going to get your heart so that you can say you love that individual, they got to prove to you that they love you. Come on, sisters. You know how you do. You make it hard for us. Amen. Hey, girl, you know, I really like to get to know you. So
let's do this. Let's go to dinner. I'm gonna take you to Angelina's for dinner. You know, it's a new place downtown. It's 25 star rated. You know, it's in the Michelin, North Carolina, and Florida books. And all their chefs came from Europe. And what you do? Well, you know what? I don't do Angelina's. If you want to get to know me, you got to come have coffee with me at Starbucks. What? Wait. Making it hard. Trying to see if he or she is going to jump through the hoops. You know, yeah. No. Here's the thing. You know you like Maxwell as well as he does, as well as she does. Girl, I got front row tickets to the Maxwell concert. Well, you know, I can't go to Maxwell because see, I'm trying to live my life differently now. I'm here for the Lord. And the whole time, look at her. She's like, I got Maxwell tickets to see. You better hurry up. Making it hard, trying to see if he's going to come back. I saw a meme the other day that said, she hasn't returned your telephone call in 18 hours. And you're going to make her wait a whole 27 seconds to return her text. Making us jump through the hoops. How, when someone does that to you, to prove that you really want to be with them, you go above and beyond. You don't let their hurdle stop you. Here's the thing. God is saying, why would you do that for that young lady or that young man, but you will not do it for me? Why would you not let anything keep you from them, but you're letting everything keep you from me? Okay, let me leave that alone. Y'all looking at me with daggers. Y'all got daggers. Amen. Amen. Where my shield? Y'all throwing daggers at me this morning. Amen. Give me my points, baby, because amen. Ron, where are the keys? Go start the car, baby. I've got to run out of here in a second. All right, so first point, can we recognize when the Lord God Almighty is in our presence? Two, how often do we let what other people want stop us from receiving what God what we most desire from the Lord God Almighty? And three, when the Lord God Almighty finally does ask us what we want him to do for us, are we prepared to answer him? When the Lord God Almighty finally does ask us what we want him to do for us, are we prepared to answer him? I saw a movie once, and in the movie, the villain kept asking the hero, what does he want? And the hero kept saying, I want my $400,000 back. The villain has stolen the $400,000. And the villain said, I can give you anything. I can give you billions of dollars. He said, I want my $400,000 back. And he finally explained, he said, because that was mine. You didn't have a right to steal it. Now, here's the thing. The hero could have been as greedy as a villain was. So, yeah, give me $2 billion. He only asked back what was his. He understood what he wanted, and he was ready to clearly articulate it. God shows up right now asking you, what do you want him to do for you? Can you clearly articulate what you want? Have you stopped and thought about what that one thing is that you could ask him to give you? Ask him to do for you. Ask him to enable you to be. Ask him to equip you with. If he came and said, what do you want me to give? Can you articulate it? You know, the problem is we talk about, you know, if I ever got to do this, if I ever won the lottery, you know, we do a whole lot of that. Because it sounds good around the lunch table, knowing we ain't buying no tickets. Amen. Over here talking about what you're going to do at the lottery, but you go in your car talking about, I ain't going to be like them fools. I ain't spending all my mortgage on no lottery tickets.
Because you never thought that the day would come when you would actually win the lottery. But you don't know God's will. And one request from God is greater than any amount of money you can win in the lottery. You don't know if you're going to come off that elevator, come around the corner, and there's God sitting right there. You don't know. So here, you're so happy. You're trying to get home to your dog, your cat, your child. You get in there and sitting in on your nice couch in the living room with the plastic on it. Amen. Sitting on your nice couch with his shoes on in your living room. Is the Lord God Almighty talking about how can I bless you today? You know, let me tell you, someone's going to be at the doctor, and the doctor's going to give you some terrible news, and the doctor's going to call themselves walking out to give you time to get yourself together, and then all of a sudden, a medical assistant that you've never seen before is going to walk into the room, is going to close the door behind you, is going to turn to you with fire in their eyes and say, what do you want for me to do? Are you prepared to tell them that you want to be healed? Are you prepared to tell them that you want to come out from under cancer? Are you prepared to tell them that you want your loved one to walk, to move, to have their faculties? Or what are you prepared to say to them? What do you want? Come on, ladies. You know, y'all do it to us all the time. Here it is. What you want? What you want? Brother Ronald, how many times you've heard that? What you want? Here it is. You coming up. You just trying to be nice and affectionate. You put your arm around her. What you want? I got to cut dinner. Move. I know Lady Nicole treats me the same way. I come up trying to wrap my arm, trying to kiss on her cheek. What's wrong with you? What's wrong? What you want? I'm like, you. Amen, Brother Sean. I know Brother Sean ain't got to worry about that because Sister Carol, boy, she should teach a class. Amen, amen. For Sister Loretta and Sister Nicole, amen, she ought to teach a class. Amen. Praise God. What you want? I know Sister Richardson back there laughing because she said that two times yesterday, didn't you? Didn't you? Brother trying to take you to dinner so you ain't got to cook. Get on what you want! What you want? Do you know what you need from God? And if you don't know, amen. So this question came up. Brother Sean will verify. We were talking about something along these lines of Bible study, and then Sister Kristen chimed in on Facebook, and she says, what if you don't know what to ask for? Amen. So the problem may be that you don't know what to ask for because you ain't never thought about it. Well, that's your prayer. Your prayer is, God, help me to be able to discern what it is I most want. You know, the worst thing to do is to give someone money they don't know what they want because they'll get everything. They will. Everything jumps out to them. Oh no, let me tell you. I need a new iMac. Amen. I don't want to pay for a car, but I need a new one. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. I got some debt I need to get out of. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. This church got some debt it needs to get out of. Amen. I'm praying that we ain't got enough seats in here. Amen. I got a laundry list. Don't ask me what I want God to do, because God's going to be mad at me. He's going to call a foul on the play. But like, boy, I said one thing. After you gave me 2,500 things. You went, God, I'm sorry. I didn't know if I was going to get this chance to talk to you again like this. So I just laid it all out there. In fact, you, God, say that you are the one who can do, there's nothing too wonderful for you, nothing too hard, too difficult. So I just sat here and thought that maybe I would give you more than one to see, God, if you really are the impossible worker that you said you are. Because I believe that you can move mountains.
presence. I believe that you can split Red Seas. I believe that you can multiply food. I believe that you can raise people from the dead. I believe that you can give sight to the blind. I believe that you can enable the paralyzed to walk. I believe that you can enable the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. I believe that you can correct any wrong. I believe that you can speak here and speak the proclamation here, and the realization is over there. God, I believe all that about you, so why wouldn't I believe that if I asked for more than one thing, you wouldn't give it to me? Amen. Amen. Y'all, okay, all right.
God, they need good news. They need good news, God. Amen. I was trying to give them this sermon the way you wanted me to give them. They look at me like I'm crazy. Amen. Amen. God, so help me with some good news, all right? Sugar, don't worry about it. This point is not up there. This is a fourth point. It's not up there. So don't even worry about trying to bring it up. Amen. If we will take the time to think through what it is we want from God, all right? If we will take the time, when we meet God, God will give you what you want. Okay. My mama is sitting right here you hear me talk about her cooking. I'm not going to talk about her cooking today. Amen. See? Look at you. You were expecting me to say my mama can't cook. Look at you. You were looking for that story, weren't you? Uh-huh. I'm not going to say it that she can't cook. It's none of your business that she can't cook. That's between me and her that she can't cook. You didn't have to live with her non-cooking self. I did. My brother did. So please let us have our way with my mama who can't cook. My mama used to say to my brother and I, and she'd be absolutely right. She says, I know when you want something and when you don't want it. She said, we buy you something and you don't want it, you just like, you didn't mention it, you didn't talk about it, you didn't do anything. She said, but when you all want something, ooh, every time you see, ooh. I mean, my mother and father, amen, see, nowadays they don't really do a lot of toys. But back in the day, Richway, Brindle, Service Merchandise, they had toy departments to rival any other kind of department. And my parents used to hate taking us with them to these kind of stores because they knew they were going to have to somehow make a trip through the toy store and the toy department. And when we got in there, our eyes would grow to be this big, and we would go to that thing we want, and we want, I want this, I want this. Start crying, start performing on them. And I mean, this is embarrassing, my parents. Amen. Hey, I didn't realize how bad it was. We got my own kids. Amen. And just, my wife called me one day and said, could you please come over here? Your son is over here hollering, crying. Your daughter is hollering, crying to get some kind of toy. I didn't realize how bad I made them look. And you know, because how much you were, my mom said, how much you were able to articulate. It wasn't just showing out a story. It was every time we talked, it was, Mom, do you know why this toy is so awesome, so great? I had reasons. Amen. Praise God. Why this toy was better than all the other ones. I had reasons. She could tell by the amount of my being able to articulate what I want and why I want, showed you what I want. Here's the thing with our God. And let me help someone here. Amen. I'm going to be done. Let me help someone here. Amen. Praise God. Someone is sitting here with your sophisticated self, your edumacated self, and you're trying to remind me that God is omniscient. And you're trying to remind me that omniscient means all-knowing. And that when we use this descriptor with God, what we're trying to say is that God knows everything. And therefore, if God knows everything, why do I need to say anything to him? I got you with your old smart behind. Amen. That ain't the word I want to use. I'm in church right now. Amen. With your old smart behind. I got you. Amen. Praise God. The issue of our being able to articulate what we want has nothing to do with God's knowledge. God knows. The issue is, can you humble yourself before God
to get what it is you want or need. Let me tell you, there are a lot of people in this world that are going to die not getting what they need or what they want because they cannot humble themselves to ask for it. There's people that are going to die estranged from one another because they're not humble enough to go ask for forgiveness. There are people that are going to die without fulfilling or achieving their dreams and objectives because they're not humble enough to go down and apply for something. God wants to see if you humble enough. Can you operate in humility? And I know for some of us, especially, the more he's let you have, the more arrogant you get. Amen. Amen. Come on. Be for real. Amen. Praise God. Brother Sean sitting here wearing a Brooks Brothers suit. I asked him for the suit, and Brother Sean told me, guess what this said to me. Amen. I'm trying to. Amen. Now we the same size, weigh the same amount of weight. And he, look at him now. Amen. And told me, you can't fit this suit. I mean, it may be a little tight, but I got a teller that can work magic. Well, amen. Praise God. And I told him, I said, you're retired. You need one suit. What retired person you know walking around the house fully dressed in a suit? You need one suit so you can come to church, come to a funeral, go to a wedding. This one suit. That's it. Got all these nice suits and nice ties. They won't even share with me. Amen. But what I keep doing, I keep trying to humble myself before Sean. I keep trying to say, Brother Sean, you don't need that. You don't need that nice. He came in the morning. I said, you don't need that nice tie. You really don't need that nice tie. You don't need. I keep humbling myself. Hopefully, that one day he'll be like, you know what, Pastor Al, you're right. I'm blessed. I got too much stuff here. Why don't you just come to my house and take all my suits? Just take them all. Take all my ties. Amen. I don't need them. I'm just going to sit here with Lady Carol for the rest of my life, and we just going to watch The Price is Right and The View. Amen. That's what we're going to watch for the rest of our lives. Amen. Can you humble yourself? Now, here's the thing. And that's what prayer really is about. Prayer is about humility. It's about getting before God, lowering your shields, lowering your arrogance, lowering your pride, and saying, God, I cannot do this by myself. I cannot accomplish this by myself. I need your help. Same thing here. Can you, when God says, what do you want? And if you can humble yourself, guess what? There's nothing he won't give you. Okay, so y'all should have been praising on that. I know. Amen, lights. Amen, lights. If you can articulate what it is, if you can be humble enough about saying, telling God what it is that you need, then God will turn around and give you everything you need. Every penny you need, every bit of support you need, every resource you need, every person you need, every opportunity you need, God will give you everything. In fact, those who trust in the Lord, those who depend on the Lord, never go without anything. The word says, I was old, young, and now I'm old. But never, ever have I seen the righteous forsaken or seed begging for bread. That's God's promise, saying that he will make sure that if you can humble yourself, if you can operate in humility, you'll never go out. In fact, the word says, try me, test me herewith. See if I will not open up the windows of heavens, not the doors, not the garage doors, not the fences, not the gates, just the windows. Amen. And here's the thing. All right, so let me show you something because you don't want to believe me. Amen. Amen. This is the door. This is the door. God doesn't promise to open the door. He promised to open the window. And the blessings that come out the window are so much so you won't have room enough to contain them. If you would just trust God, humble yourself, God wants to give you everything. God wants to give you everything. God wants to give you everything. You have not because you ask not. Let me change that. You have not because you humble yourself not. You have not because you don't think less of yourself than you should. Don't you know that you aren't nothing to God? You are just a speck of dust on the bottom of his shoe. Why should he ever move, care about what you want? But the God we love, the God that loves us so much that he will bless us in spite of us only being a mere speck of dust to him. He acts like we are just like him, that we are as holy as him, as righteous as him, as circumspect as him, as upstanding as him. He acts like we are him or a part of him, and we are. And he decides to bless us like he blesses his son. Amen. I'm done now. I'm done now. I'm trying to help someone here. Amen. Because you've been looking, you've been wondering, you've been asking God to bless you beyond belief. And you're wondering why he has not blessed you beyond belief yet. Let me suggest to someone that's not saved, before he will bless you beyond belief, he needs you to commit yourself to him. Amen. Praise God. As I get older, I'm starting to see how much she loves my friends as much as us. Amen. Because my own children are starting to develop real friends. Amen. And you start to develop relationships with your children's friends. Amen. But as much as my parents love my friends, there is a limit for what they'll do for the friends, because the friends are not her sons. Amen. Same thing. And your parents too. Y'all sure your parents love the friends you have chosen, at least most of them, and they would do some things, but they wouldn't do for the friend what they do for you. That's because you belong to them. The friends do not. We want God to bless us as a parent blesses a child, yet we will not take the steps to give ourselves to him so that we belong to him. And so the first thing you can do, because I know there's someone under the sound of my voice, the first thing you can do to ensure that you are in the right relationship with God so that when it comes time to articulate what you most want, then God, and so that God will give it to you, that you're in that right place. The first step is to accept his son, Christ Jesus, as your personal Lord and Savior. I don't care what you've done. I don't care where you've been. I don't care who you've been around. I don't care what you said. I don't care what you thought. There's no sin that Christ Jesus did not die for. When he got up on that cross, amen, amen, they nailed him to the cross. He nailed every single form of sin there is. So there's nothing you can tell me that you've done that my God will not forgive. Amen. And since that's true, let me lead you to him in the free pardons of your sins. With all heads bowed, all eyes closed, we pray this prayer together. Dear Father God, creator of the heavens and the earth, thank you, God, for how you love me. Thank you, God, for how you shower me. Thank you, God, for how you bless me, God. God, you have done an amazing and a great thing in my life, God. You have kept me, God, even when I wasn't sure, I wasn't certain that I wanted you to keep me. When I was too busy running away from you, God, too busy fighting you, too busy challenging you, too busy disbelieving you, God, you love me nevertheless. And you love me
based on the anticipation that one day you and I will become father and son, father and daughter, father and child. And you've been moving heaven and earth for that day to come. Well, that day is here now. And Father God, we pray right now for that person who wants to be a believer. God, we pray that God, you would move upon their hearts so that they would believe in their hearts and believe in their minds and confess with their mouths that Jesus is Lord to your glory. That God, that they will confess that Jesus did come, Jesus did live, Jesus did serve, Jesus did minister. He was arrested. He was charged. He was tried. He was found guilty. He was inhumanely brutalized, God, and they still made him carry his cross to Golgotha, where they hung him high and stretched him wide, God, where they tortured him even more, where, God, they made him suffer not only the torture, but the impunity, God, the shame, the ridicule, God. And God, at some point, he did die, and they took him down, and they did bury him in a borrowed grave. But early on Sunday morning, God, you raised him with all glory in his right hand, and you gave him the keys to heaven and earth. And God, you made him the judge and the final authority on every living being. And God, we thank you, God, that we have a chance to accept him in our hearts, in our lives. God, we thank you for the chance to, God, become connected to him, to become children of his, to be covered by his blood, to be hidden behind this cross. God, we thank you for that. And God, we pray that, God, as we are coming to you, as we are giving ourselves to you, God, that not only will you accept us, but God, you'll clean us up, God, that you'll straighten us up, that you will fix us, heal us, restore us, reconcile us, renovate us, do whatever you need to do to transform us from an adversary to a disciple and steward. And God, allow us to live lives that bring glory to your name. And when it's said and done, God, please come down here and get us. Collect us personally. Take us back to heaven to live with you and to be a part of what you've got going on there in heaven. Father God, we love you and we thank you. It's in your son's mighty, matchless, marvelous, magnificent name that we do pray. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer for the very first time today, what I want you to do, amen. I'm seeing everyone here. Amen. I know everyone here. So that means I'm talking to you in internet land. Amen. If you have accepted Christ for the very first time today, what I want you to do is send me an email or a private message. Amen. Praise God. If you're on Facebook, send me a private message to my Facebook profile, Al Kennan. Amen. You should see this face somewhere on my Facebook page. If you're on YouTube, amen. There it is. There's my email address, Pastor Al Kennan III at gmail.com. Those are three I's, not three ones. Send me the email. Tell me, or send me the private message. Tell me that you've accepted Christ for the very first time today, and we will begin our walk together. I believe that we do not put newborn babies into a corner and tell them to raise themselves. We raise them, we nurture them, we care for them, we provide for them, we protect them till they can protect themselves as self-sustaining adults. Same thing. We don't birth spiritual babes in a corner and say, babe, you're on your own. We nurture them, we grow them, we help them be growing to full-fledged Christian disciples and stewards who are able to glorify God on their own. And so if I'm talking to you, please, please, please send me that email, send me that direct message, and we will get busy walking together. Amen. Praise God. Amen. It has been such a pleasure, such a